Thanks everyone for attending the meeting. I'm Robert. I'm the Director of Product Management for Crew here at Navtech. I want to give you a brief overview of Navtech. There are a number of products that we currently deliver as part of Navtech, and these include aircraft performance, charts, crew planning, which we're going to talk about today, electronic flight bag, flight planning, and navigational data. A brief overview of some of our customers. We have a little over 300 airline customers around the world. These are just some of a quick snapshot of some of them. Some of them are on the call. Along with our products that Navtech offers, we have a couple of key partnerships to round out a crew management suite. These include eTrip Trader. Now this is a crew mobile trip trading application optimized for mobile devices. It allows crews to drop trips, swap trips. There's a trade board that they can manage trips around their schedules. IBS, they offer a crew management suite, which includes crew tracking, aircraft tracking, and a manpower planning suite. The Navtech pieces, so these are the pieces that Navtech maintains and develops and delivers. Within that, there's a preferential bidding system and a pairing optimizer. And I've bolded the pairing optimizer because we'll be reviewing that today. A key product in the industry nowadays is fatigue risk management. So Navtech has partnered with IBR, the Institute of Behavioral Resources, to offer their Safety Fast FRMS, which is now integrated into our preferential bidding system and our pairing optimizer. So that allows an airline to view pairings and rosters from a fatigue perspective, and through an iteration of analyzing the pairings and or rosters, they would make adjustments to the rules and re-optimize. A key thing with our product is optimization, and Navtech is located in Waterloo, Ontario. We're actually on the University of Waterloo Research Park campus. Now, the University of Waterloo is a world-renowned university for mathematics, engineering, and computer science. So we've benefited from that proximity and that partnership to do additional research into optimization. A key point with Navtech and its crew products is that we have a strong focus on our customers. And this focus includes a yearly focus group, typically here in Waterloo, that allows our airlines to come here, interact with our development staff, some of the research students that we have working from the University of Waterloo. The groups typically meet over 2 days, and we focus on product enhancements, product roadmap, industry trends, and where we need to be taking our product in the near term and in the long term. This year, that event is held in October. Actually, the dates on that screen is wrong. It's actually October 2nd and 3rd. I apologize for that. Along with the yearly focus group, we have quarterly web meetings with all our crew customers. And again, we are discussing product enhancements. Typically what comes out of these product enhancements, airline industry trends, and plotting out our roadmap for the future. We augment this further with a monthly account management call with each airline to discuss their specific items that's related to their day-to-day operations. A little bit more about the research project with the University of Waterloo. And I failed to mention, I'm going to have a questions and answer at the end. There's the dialogue box where you can ask questions. So if you can enter your questions there, we'll carve out 10, 15 minutes at the end, and we'll go through any of your questions. So that research project with the University of Waterloo has actually won us an award, the Canadian Operational Research Award. This particular award has not been assigned for the last 3-plus years, so it's actually an honor to win this. And the focus of the research for this award was actually on the pairing optimizer and ways to improve the optimization process, both from a cost perspective savings for airlines and from a runtime perspective savings. So the work is now being done to take those findings and roll it back into the product. So our goal is to make incremental changes as we can commercialize some of those results from that research. So I'm going to drill down a little, talk about our pairing optimizer and the fatigue risk management system and what makes us unique. So our pairing optimizer takes a schedule file, typically a SIM file from an airline, and we build optimal pairings. The system is Windows-based. It installs on an analyst or a planner's PC. There is no special hardware required. We do recommend a minimum system requirement, and I can review that at the end. Some key things about our system: there is no third-party commercial solvers. We did benchmark with some of the commercial solvers in the market. And we currently use an open source solver, and we found that the open source solver performed as good. Benefit for the airlines that they don't have to pay a third-party license, so we save the airlines that yearly third-party license. A key thing with our system, it is in real time. The planner, through the interface, can make adjustments to the rules, any of the parameters, and see the impact instantly. Another key benefit is that you're never waiting around for a solution to find that it's infeasible. The system gets you a solution fairly quickly, and then you can steer the system towards a desired solution from that point onward and see that impact of making those changes instantly. Within the product, we do have some fatigue management parameters, and they include the WACL, the Windows Security and Low. We do have a point-based fatigue constraints, so we assign a point value to fatiguing aspects of a pairing, and we'll build a pairing up to a maximum point level. Also contained within the fatigue management, within the optimizer, we have a circadian rhythm parameter, and you can define a circadian rhythm over a course of 3-day, 4-day, 5-day pairings. The key difference between us and a lot of the systems in the market, we use a subset optimization method, and using that method, we typically find savings over a global optimization method, which is the norm for most optimizers in the market. Just to show you an example of some benchmarks that we have done and the savings we typically find. This airline, 42 narrow-body aircraft, 9,500 plus legs in a monthly schedule. And we focused on a couple of key areas, specifically deadhead and hotels. And by focusing on that, those areas, we were able to find $54,000 in savings for this monthly solution. So on the graph on the side, the ALC are the aircraft statistics using their current system, Navtech results, and the savings we identified. So we did find a 0.35 savings in synthetic time. We were able to reduce the hotels by 110. I'll get to the stand-ups on the next screen. We did reduce deadheads by 17. We did reduce the deadhead time. Move to the next screen. A couple of areas that not necessarily are cost savers, but stand-ups at this airline, stand-up pairings. These are pairings that operate overnight, typically very low productivity in the early mornings. Not a big favorite of the airline or its crews. We were able to eliminate 15 stand-ups, so we were able to increase the quality of life for some of the crew members by removing some of these unliked pairings. We also, and I don't have a stat for it, we also reduced sit times. It is all, again, for the crew members, they typically want to fly. They don't want to be sitting around at an airport waiting for a flight. We reduced that. We also had a greater distribution of 1 day, 2 day, 3 day, 4 day pairings, a little more flexibility, and again, points to the crew member quality of life. A couple of other key metrics here. Average block time, we were able to increase that by 3 minutes a day, which equated to 25 less duty periods for this solution. A few more key benefits of our system. Because we use the subset optimization, the run times are quite fast. I do have a scenario that I'll step you through. There's approximately 3,000 flight legs, and we can put that together in a matter of seconds. The system does allow you to run multiple. The solution times will increase because you're competing for CPU power by having more than one solution running. But that may be acceptable depending on your fleet type and what scenarios you're running. So with fast run times and multiple, the ability to run multiple scenarios, we typically compress your planning cycles. We have detailed reporting, and I'll step you through our application to show you some examples. But a number of reports around productivity and costs, pairing reports, and the statistics within a pairing. For example, the number of 1 day, 2 day, 3 day, the number of early starts, late ends, the length of sit times. So very comprehensive reports. And all the reports can be generated as an entire solution, or you can do it base by base. Another thing that we do when we load in your schedule, your SIM file, and we generate a schedule that we use within the optimizer, we can identify the crew complement per flight leg and language positions per flight leg. Our flight attendants. And for rules, currently the system is configured for Canadian regulations, U.S. regulations, including Part 117, so those are the rules that take effect in January 2014. We also have the EU Subpart Q rules and the UK CAP 371 rules configured in the system. Moving over to the IBR Safety Fast system. The key benefits here is IBR has benefited from 20 plus years of data analysis into fatigue, specifically with flight crews. All this data has been compiled through actigraphs. It's been rolled into the model. It is in use with the FAA in the United States. It was selected because the model compared to the other models on the market, had the least amount of errors, and that again points to the amount of data and research that's been done over the 20 plus years. The modeler has a visual interface and allows you to run scenarios to mitigate low alertness at critical points of the flight, at takeoff and landing. Within the system, there is a manager interface where you can filter pairings and or rosters to identify the pairings that have the low alertness and allows you to analyze those in greater detail and look for ways to mitigate that low alertness. It is fully configurable, so within that manager you can define fatigue criteria, metrics. For example, you can set a level of low alertness that's acceptable. For example, anything below 78% would be of concern. Anything above it would be acceptable. And integration, it is integrated with the Navtech Pairing Optimizer and our PBS. Just to show a graphic of that interface and how these modules can work together. So we see it as currently as an iterative collaboration where you would generate pairings and or rosters, load them into SafetyFast, analyze them, make any adjustments, and do this iterative approach to mitigate that low alertness. So within the SafetyFast system, there's actually three components. There's the modeler. So here's where we would output our results from our pairings and our rosters. And here's where you would set criteria for minimum rest, in-flight rest, alertness levels. Those results will be fed into a manager where you can actually drill down and focus on some key areas. And from there, you can actually go into the modeler and run some scenarios. So I'll step you through that, the next part after this presentation. Another way that you can utilize this system is to analyze fatigue reports coming in from crews. So we have a couple of examples here. So this operator is a long-haul operator from the U.S. West Coast to Asia. Now the crews filed a complaint within the crew rest facility on the aircraft. The lights within that compartment were switching on and off randomly, so it made it difficult for the crews to get adequate rest. We ran this pairing to the modeler, and the area where the arrows point to, hopefully that this graphic isn't too small, but if they had adequate rest or their planned rest, their alertness level when the aircraft was landing was quite high. It was 98%. When we then ran a scenario and removed that in-flight rest based on this fatigue report, because the crew members were complaining that the lights made it difficult for them to rest, we ran the modeler again, and you can see that their alertness level had dropped significantly. It's into the yellow here at 83%. Another example, again, a long-haul operator from Australia to Asia. The crew filed a fatigue report because of the hotel they were staying at. There was some construction outside, and the noise from that construction made it difficult for them to sleep. Again, we ran that roster through the optimizer, through the fatigue risk management system. And when they had their rest, which was actually here before their operating duty. When they took off, their alertness was quite high. It was good. And when they land the aircraft, they are into the yellow, but it's still acceptable based on the criteria set. It's above 80%. The model below, we ran that schedule and degraded that rest at the hotel. So when they take off, their alertness has dropped. And when they land the aircraft, again, their alertness has dropped from 80%, including their onboard rest. So the sleep from the previous night had obviously affected, or the lack of sleep the previous night had obviously affected their alertness at both takeoff and landing. That is the presentation piece. I was going to switch over and actually show you the applications. I was first going to focus on the pairing optimizer and then switch over to the FRMS. If I don't get to all your questions, or if you have any additional questions, please take a note of my email address there and send me a note with any questions that you may have. So it's rmora@navtech.arrow. So I'm going to switch over to my desktop and step you through the applications. So I'll step you through our pairing optimizer. And again, it is Windows-based application, installs on a planner's or analyst's PC. Everything is point and click. We typically input from a SIM file. Quite intuitive. It steps you through exactly what you need to set. So it tells you to select the first day of the scheduling period. Select the last day of the scheduling period. Once you define the period, we also bring in a station file. This station file basically lists all the stations that you operate to, their GMT offset, their daylight savings triggers, so when daylight savings occurs, the time of day it occurs, both in the spring and the fall. And we maintain longitude and latitude information for the fatigue risk management system and also for the new U.S. regulations, where it's based on longitude and latitude. The rules that apply for this station, so in this example here, Billings, Montana, when operating into that station, North American domestic rules would apply. If you look below, some destinations in Mexico, North American international rules would apply. And I'll show you on the interface how those rules are triggered. Crew rules, so these are the rules. We list the aircraft type and the crew complement required on each aircraft type. The interface allows you to start a cold solution, which would be a fresh start, or a warm start. So I'll do a warm start. I'll pick up where I left off. And again, the interface, this is pretty intuitive. It's all point and click. You select your date ranges. You select your aircraft types. You select your crew complement. I'll just cycle through these files and get to the interface. Another key benefit with the system is that I am starting in the cold monthly, so I've skipped typically a lot of the global multiple optimizers. You need to solve a daily solution, take that daily solution, expand it into a weekly, solve the weekly, take that weekly, expand it into monthly, solve the monthly. We can start cool in a month, so saving you time and effort to do those two other steps. I'll step you through some of the parameters. So basing, here's where you define your basing. You can set the constraint of hours in each base, and obviously tell the optimizer to move that flying to where your resources are. You can define which base fly which equipment types. Parameters for building individual duty periods, and you'll see a lot of our parameters here have a desired value and a worst okay. This points to the crew quality of life by steering the system towards a desired level and a worst okay level if I need to. Maximum flight time per duty, maximum connection time between live segments, maximum connection time from operating to deadhead segments, and connection time between deadhead segments. Again, if you want to avoid sit times, you would tell the system my desired value is 40, my worst okay is 3. And I can tell the system with an optimization cost or linear cost, which steers the system towards the desired value. But it would still, if it has to, use the worst okay value. Minimum connection times. Now you can define this a number of ways. By station, base station, by chain station, if it's coming from somewhere, going to somewhere. The time, if no plane change is required. If a plane change is required, if an aircraft type change is required. If the arriving segment is from a theater of operation, departing to a theater of operation, it may require different rest. If it's going from operating to deadheading, it may require a different connection time. If it's any special type of duty, the other thing that you can do is you can define this by day. For example, if you're operating to a busy airport, a busy international airport that has a lot of flights in the afternoon, you may want the connection times to be increased during that window. Number of aircraft changes per duty period. And again, there's optimization costs. For example, here I don't have an optimization cost if there's one plane change. But I'm telling the system that I prefer you not to change two, and it's really not desired for you to have three aircraft changes within a duty period. Segment type specifications. So within here, we can define charter flights, ferry flights, a number of special flights here, and we can have a different set of rules apply to those flights. Deadhead usage. Within here, I can steer the system. For the example here, I have no cost if I need a deadhead to start a duty, but I have a very high cost if a deadhead is in the middle of a duty. Maximum deadheads per duty, per trip. If I do use a deadhead, does it extend my duty day? And I can extend that by domestic, international, if it's to base or to another station. And I can prohibit deadheads to happen back to back, so going from one deadhead to another deadhead. Or if it's required, I can allow it. Moving into productivity constraints, so I can define the amount of productivity for 1 day, 2 day, 3 day, 4 day, 5 day pairings. I can define maximum duty break and have a linear cost. So if I want to keep the duty break to 12 hours, but if I go any higher than that, there's a linear cost in doing so. So I'm steering the system towards my desired value. Augmenting. We have augmenting rules and how to augment within a pairing. station-by-station rules. Certain stations may require extra turnaround time, extra minimum duty break. Here's where we define all that. Carryout restrictions. In some cases, airlines want to minimize the amount of carryout trips to avoid the transition problem from month to month. Cost parameters. So here's where we have a global setting here where you maintain your real costs in blue. The white column is optimization cost. For example, here I have a high optimization cost to ensure that the crews are getting the minimum guarantee that's required per day. I have the ability to optimize on your actual hotel costs. We load in a file for that, or have a overall hotel cost. Again, and I'll step you through an example. We also have the ability to do that for deadheads and meal breaks if you have those type of rules. Briefing times. So similar to the connection times, you can define this by base. If you're coming from a certain station, going to a certain station. If you're coming from a theater of operation, you may need extra briefing times. That set is virtually the same for debriefing times. Maximum flight duty time, and going back to that station file, and I showed that flagging. Well, here's where you would define the duty period type, which would then cross-reference that station and that flag that you have set and apply the rules that are required. So for here, for domestic, between these hours, maximum flight duty period is 14 hours for the number of segments. Within here, we've actually set a desired limit, so we've buffered this. We don't want to go to the maximum. We want to avoid that. We actually have an optimization cost. If you're going five segments, we want you to avoid five segments unless it's optimal to do so. Flags, we can now go to 16 hours. We also have an international version, and you can have a number of these versions. Actually, the new US FARs, there's a series of these. And these are all defined by report time and the amount of flight duty period that you can do within that report time. Maximum flight duty special cases. So typically, if an airline does some unique flying, when we configure the system, we define your special rules for that type of flying. And again, the planner can adjust and buffer those rules. The alternate maximum duty times, this typically applies to some international duties. Not so much a North American thing on this screen. Night duties, red eyes, split duties. So basically here's where you define what the window of circadian low is and what you can and cannot do within that window. Same applies for red eyes. You define when a red eye occurs and what you can do before and after a red eye in total for a red eye. And the same case for split duties. You define when a split duty occurs and what you can and can't do within that split duty. Minimum duty break. Again, the desired and worst okay for minimum duty break, depending on a domestic station, international station. These are all configurable by the planner. Minimum duty break special cases. Again, if you have any unique type of flying during the requirements phase of implementing our system, we would define this. And again, we give your planner the ability to set a desired level and a worst okay and a linear cost to steer the system towards that desired level. duty rigs, trip rigs. So typically here's where you set your rigs for deadheads, daytime rigs, nighttime rigs, trip rig, minimum guarantees, and there's a number of ways to set these. And to kind of round this out, here are the rules that we have configured. The FARs, main rules, EU rules, UK rules, and the new FARs. Or you can run under none and set your rest as you desire and run a solution and a scenario on that. So once the rules are set, I have my schedule, it's loaded into the system. I'm going to start off the optimization process. And I want you to pay attention, if you could, to this column here, but bad trips. It'll move pretty quickly. So we start off with approximately 3,000 individual flight legs. And we get it down to a point of about 150 within, like I said, it's a matter of seconds. Well, watch the process. Again, the column in red under bad trips. Why is it bad trips? Well, it's not a legal pairing. So it's considered a bad trip. So our plan name, and we can run six scenarios at the same time. Machine that this is loaded on. The flight time for this schedule period. So there's approximately 22,000 flight hours. Deadhead time. Well, we haven't allowed deadheads. We'll introduce deadheads later when we need to. So there is no deadhead time. And in this scenario here, there is no minimum guarantee. The only credit or rig that they pay is on deadheading. So when I introduce deadheads, you'll see that these numbers will change. Solution cost, here are those linear costs. So any linear cost that we have set, steer the system towards desired level, is calculated there. True costs, or any actual costs. So your actual hotel costs, your actual hourly costs for your crew member, calculated here. Number of duty periods, well, that number is changing as we're optimizing. Number of days, number of trips, and again, bad trips. So we started off at 3,000, we're at 160. Basing, if my basing was out, it would show the amount that it is out, and there's an optimization cost to steer the system towards a balanced level. Number of hotel rooms, 103, and I'm just going to make a note of that number. Iterations, so this particular scenario has been running for 1,500 iterations. That is 120 computer seconds. And last improvement, so the last second it made an improvement. So when you see this number increasing and this number not changing, it is a good indication that it is good to get, as good as it's going to get with the parameters you have set. You may want to adjust a parameter or actually publish the results. We have 160 bad trips. I'm actually going to introduce some deadheads. Now we can define deadheads a number of ways. We can define deadheads from station to station on specific dates. But in this case here, I'll just tell the system any flight leg is available for deadheading purposes. I made that change. Introduce that change into the optimization process, and you'll see that the bad trips are now going down because we've introduced deadheads. We now have deadhead time, synthetic time, and a synthetic percentage, and that percentage is just wasted. You're paying the crews to deadhead when and not operate the aircraft. You notice our hotel costs have got down, but our key point that we want to get to is cover all our trips. And we're almost there. At any point, we can take a snapshot of the solution, evaluate it. Any trip in red is not a legal pairing. And when you open it, it'll tell you exactly what's wrong with it. So this does not have a, this pairing does not stop or start in a crew base. Anything in white is a legal pairing. And we can have the cost breakdown of that pairing, individual pairing. And we also show any artificial costs or optimization costs that we have set that takes us, that is triggered on this pairing. Our deadheads are coming down. We've eliminated some deadheads. There's still one bad trip. That'll be cleaned up in a few seconds. And at any point during the optimization process, for example, I now have 89 hotels. That may be too high for this solution. I'll go in and increase the later cost on hotels and introduce that new cost into the solution. And you notice our hotel count is coming down. We've covered off all our bad trips, and now we're focusing on eliminating some hotel costs. And we can leave this running, and we can go and look at some of the additional reports. A good report to look at when you're doing this iterative optimization is your cost breakdown. We have all costs below. We have it broken out by crew, by base. So all the key stats that you would expect, block time, segment credit, credit, synthetic percentage for the base, average duty per duty period, average block per duty period, average block per day, deadhead time, domestic time away from base, international time away from base, number of days and duty periods in this base, and the actual number of live segments in that base. Hotel costs by base, the total cost, and the actual cost that's used there is whatever hotel files and costs that you loaded into the system. Deadheads, so deadhead by base, and again, if you actually load in a cost per deadhead, that'll be displayed here. If your operation uses meals, either boarded meals or paid meals, we'll display that here. Limos or ground transportation, if that is required, we display that here and the cost. Another key report is the actual pairings. Now we can sort this a number of ways. I just clicked on the default setting. A trip number, report time, release time, crew complement on this pairing. It is a one-day trip with two legs in it. The block time to the first leg, connection time to the next leg, total block, total duty for the pairing, and on the far side, the calendar on when this pairing operates. Now at the bottom of this report, we have all the stats per trip. So we do it by base. So the number of one-day pairings, number of two-day pairings. So we can go into the system and actually steer it now towards three-day and four-day if that's what we want. Distribution of calendar days. We can define commutable trips. So what is a desirable commute time? For example, 10 o'clock. Anything after 10 o'clock is good to start a commutable trip, as long as it's duties off after 6. So we can define what a commutable trip is. Show stats on that. A couple of other key stats. Connection times with aircraft swap, with no aircraft swap. In total cases, long connection times. And as I highlighted, if there isn't a stat that we don't have, and we do have a lot of them, it's a fairly easy thing to develop a new one on these reports. Given the time, I'm going to switch over to the FRMS. So I can leave that running, and I can go off on my computer and do additional work. So I'm actually loading up a pairing. It is a multiple day pairing. It's actually a long pairing. It starts on the 11th and on the 20th. The blue periods are the rest periods. The red periods, the red are when they're on duty. In-flight rest facility. When we start off here, when they take off, they're at 97% alertness. This crew lands this aircraft, they're at 86% alertness. Now we can adjust any of these events. With in-flight rest, I'll change it to good. They may have a bunk, which we classify that as good. And rerun this scenario to see if the alertness level has increased. That landing, it has slightly. So the red line is actually their sleep reservoir. So as you're sleeping, this obviously builds up. At 100% means you're fully rested. The gray line is when you're not on duty. The black line is when you are on duty. So as you see on this first example here, as they wake up, they start depleting from this reservoir. And when they rest, they start rebuilding that reservoir. In this example here, over this multiple day pairing, you can see that they never fully recover. And at a couple of points, when they're operating, their alertness level is good. In this example here, they're above the threshold. They have set at 77. But on landing, they're well below the alertness level that you would set. I'll switch over to questions and answers. And again, just a reminder, my email address is rmora@navtech.aero. If I don't get to your questions or if you have any additional questions, please feel free to shoot me off an email and I'll follow up with you. So going through some of the questions, which open source solver do we use? It's LPSolve. So that's the open source solver that we use. The next question we have is, can we deal with non-scheduled operations? What we input into our system is a SIM file. So if those legs are within that SIM file, the answer is yes. We have imported other schedule files that are non-SIM. The key points is that we need to know when the flight departs, the station it departs from, arrival station, the arrival time, the equipment type, and the next leg information, if there is any next leg information. So we don't necessarily need a SIM. I refer to the SIM because it is fairly industry standard, but if you don't have a SIM, we have imported other formats, but the key points is that we need the key details of when the aircraft parts and lands and the equipment type on it. Another question that came from our previous session was minimum system requirements. Now we recommend a workstation. It could be a laptop, it could be a workstation with Windows 7 64-bit. 64-bit is required. Our system does use multiple threading, and to take advantage of that, we do need the 64-bit system. We recommend an Intel i7 processor. It will run on other Intel processors, an i5, for example, but our recommendation is an i7. And we do recommend 4 gigabytes of memory. So while the system is running, it does use a fair amount of memory, and it does use a lot of the CPU power, So the memory actually allows you to go off and do other work. As you've seen, I was working within the FRMS while the optimizer was still running. I do have an additional question. So do you have a trial version for us to test? The answer to that is that what we typically do is that we come in and run a benchmark with you guys, and that would be our trial, if you like. We benchmark against your current systems, enter your rules, enter your SIM file for the same period, and generate results and compare those results. So that's typically what we do in a trial. But we don't have a dedicated trial version that we hand over to you. There is a little bit of training involved to run the optimizer. Not a lot. Our typical training cycle is over 3 months, 2 days over those 3 months where we sit with the planners and actually generate results together. So we create a schedule file, set up the parameters, generate the results, evaluate the results, adjust parameters until we get a solution that meets your operational constraints and the other constraints that you may have. Yeah, next question I have. Thanks, Ginny. There is an editor within the system, and you can lock pairings. If you recall the interface that I showed, when I bring up a pairing, I can actually lock it and remove it from the optimization process. There's also an editor where you can pre-build a pairing and lock it. Just a reminder, if something does come to mind, feel free to send me an email. And I'd like to thank you for your time.